this week on the Push Pull Legs podcast, we're joined by Steve Hall, the founder of Team Revive Stronger. We chat flexible dieting, flexible training, and we ask him some pretty great questions. Lastly, of course, he plays stupid things on the internet this week.
Three, two, one. We're here with Team Revive. All right, guys, we have one more week without Daniel Meek. He is still in Doha or Dubai or something, celebrity training. He's just spent out a good hefty amount of money on his child, I believe, which is good. He's getting paid a hell of a lot to be out there, so all wonderful. But whilst we thought we'd sneak one last interview in before he comes back, basically, which I think we'll let to believe maybe the one that comes back, we haven't had him rant for a while, so it might be a stupid things on the internet kind of special of some sort. But who I have sitting with me, with a guy with a great surname, which is literally how I contacted him, Mr. Steve Hall. How you doing, bud?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. Thank you for having me.
No worries, man. No worries. You are one of the guys that on social media that I've followed for a while since you've been doing your stuff, and I think I know a couple of your clients, so that's kind of where I found you. And I do believe that we've been to a couple of the same seminary workshops or stuff together without knowing each other, or might have known each other, but that awkward thing where I think I know you but you're totally online, so I don't know whether to say hello or anything like that. I'm pretty sure that's probably happened,
but probably. I think it happens a lot, and I'm bad for that, especially, or years ago I used to be much worse. I'm getting better as you age, you get a bit more confident, and I've always been a bit of a shy person, but it's definitely good to just, like, if you see me, just say hi. But anything run by, like, Luke Johnson, Shredded by Science, I basically go to every single one that they will run, just because if it's in, they're basically all in London, so it's like, why not?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I'm pretty sure, considering on one of the, on your Facebook page is you with 3DMJ. I was at that conference as well.
Awesome.
That was one of the best takeaways. We did a whole podcast on it and obviously invited Brad on because I thought he smashed it. But yeah, probably one of the best conferences I've been to in quite a while. Obviously, I went to like the PTT whatever conference in, I think Luke did it again in Bath, right? Yeah, which was pretty good. That was long 2 days though. That was the only thing.
Yeah.
It was just kind of like, oh, here's knowledge. So for people who maybe don't know who you are just following me and Dan, like we're the best things in the world, there are other people that do stuff. So one of the reasons why I reached out to Steve is that he advocates for basically a lot of the stuff that myself and Dan do. And he is a successful online presence. So Steve, talk about a little bit who you are, where you've come from, what your team is.
Cool.
Go, man.
So I am Steve Hall, and I have the site revivestronger.com, which is like a blog, which I put out posts like every week. I've been kind of posting out there with basically just information and value and content for people to take away and kind of start improving their lives. And we mainly target and train with bodybuilders and powerlifters, but much so, a lot of them are people who aspire to become either bodybuilders or powerlifters, or like that lifestyle and kind of want to get strong and a great physique, because bodybuilders and powerlifters know exactly how. And obviously I am myself both a bodybuilder and powerlifter, competed in both and loved the sports kind of ever since coming out of university, training with weights, properly doing it, and then getting into flexible dieting. Actually finding that from Alan Aragon and Lyle McDonald was kind of what sprung me to actually want to compete in natural bodybuilding. So I was like, this is actually something I can do for life. Like, it's not that hard. Now I know I can eat various foods and not have to be regimented to certain things. It really freed things up for me. So yeah, it's been a journey. It's been interesting. And I guess I should say where Revive Stronger came from, in short, is I had a bit of an accident at university, which led me to poor health, basically. And then that made me find bodybuilding, weights, kind of to build myself up. And it was kind of that's me reviving stronger, as it were. And yeah, got Mark on board as well now, who has an inspirational story as well. He survived cancer, which is absolutely fantastic. And he again is just trying to help people get bigger, stronger, and healthier. So yeah, that's in short what we're about. An online training company. It's all online, so nothing one-on-one at the moment.
Yeah, man, awesome. So does that mean you have to have had some sort of disease or or something bad happen to you to work with you? I'm guessing that's not a prerequisite, but it's a great great story to come from, and it kind of gives the outline that anybody can, well, especially if you try and you work hard at most of the stuff, you're always, if you follow yourself, like, guidance-wise, you're going to get where you want to be. Both you and Mark do an awesome job. I'm actually part of Steve's little online group on Facebook, so we'll probably talk about that a little bit later. So one of the, we thought we'd go content, and then we'll learn a little bit more about Steve and what he is and what he does, kind of the back end of the show, basically. So what I'd like to talk about is... we know Steve will as well, is flexibility. Not in the sense of I'm a ballet dancer and I'm going to be all over the place. We're talking flexible dieting and flexible training / programming. These are both areas that obviously we cover extensively with clients, and what we talk about on the podcast, we've talked about extensively flexible dieting, but it's great to get something other than Mr. Dan Meek going nuts about it, so we can see that other coaches actually advocate it as well. And then we'll talk a little bit about flexible training. This is a little bit more part of my mentorship program and basically with my programming and how I'm applying it for some people. So flexible dieting, do you want to spout out what that exactly is for our listeners? Hopefully everybody should know it by now, but it still gets misconstrued in some sort of way. But any definition that you tend to use?
I think it's a really interesting question, because actually, you're at the conference, Eric Helms actually asked the audience, what is flexible dieting? And yeah. I remember answering it, because I was like using La McDonald's initial definition, which is where I first heard about it from his book, which is basically, if you screw your diet up one day, you don't kind of just binge and go mental. The next day, you just get back onto that diet, which is one kind of way I see flexible dieting. I think it's really a good thing. And then another way of thinking about it is kind of how it's become more known is like, if it fits your macros, you have these macronutrient targets, protein, fats, carbs, you eat kind of foods to your preference and hit those, making sure that you also hit fiber, fruit and vegetable content and things like that. And it makes life a lot easier. And I think that's what most people think of, but both together work really well, I think, with that. If you screw up your macros one day, like, get back on it, but you can pick and choose foods to your preferences and needs.
I mean, yeah, one of the biggest when Eric Helm was talking about that in that conference, one of the biggest things that I took away from it, and I kind of knew the like flexible dieting and everything like that, and obviously followed it, but I didn't really have much appreciation of how you can like take calories from other days. I was very rigid in terms of, all right, I've got my calorie goal of 3,200. That is exactly what I've got to hit, like plus or minus like 100 calories every single day. And then you're like, actually, we can be flexible even within flexible dieting, and the fact that we can steal. He was an advocate of taking 20% off a day if you knew you were going to binge or go out for a wedding or have that kind of night out. And then, oh, you're taking 20% from the Saturday. You got to take that from the Sunday, so you come 20% down. That was one of the big takeaways from me. But in terms of flexible dieting, what would you say so you do a lot of online coaching, which obviously would heavily feature, I'm sure, macro counts and kind of adherence, etc. Picking off the top of your head, what would you condone as good practice for flexible dieting?
I think it's finding the right flexibility for that person for that specific time. So someone in maybe their off season who is kind of slowly gaining weight might only need to track protein, calories and their body weight, and that'd be absolutely fine. And they can hit a weekly average, maybe making sure to hit protein each day and then a weekly average calorie target, and then making sure they're gaining weight at the right and appropriate speed. But then you also have to think about the person. And I know I've got clients who, even if I gave them that amount of flexibility, they'd be like, I want more rigidity. And by giving them carbs and fats, they actually feel better about it, which is a bit strange for some people. So it's all about being really individual for that person. And then for someone who's like in contest prep, like the degree of flexibility basically goes out the window, and they need to be pretty damn strict, even maybe to the degree of, right, we need to shortlist you to a certain number of foods so that you're not having any weird, wacky stuff that might make your weight go strange. I know towards the end of my contest prep, it was like, right, I can't eat these weird Weight Watchers foods and all this like other stuff that I've never eaten before. I don't know how I'm going to react, what it could do to my body weight. I need some consistency. And then you're hitting macronutrients within like 5 gram ranges, and you're sticking to like a specific calorie number. And there's no kind of taking that 20% and moving it around because you just can't afford to at that period of time. So yeah, I think it's good practice, really depends on the person and the time and what they can deal with. Because I like more gen pop population, like they probably can't even do as much as counting every macro. Like calories might be flexible, like as far as they can go. Like I'm lucky that I have a specific target audience that can do every macro most of the time. They understand the importance of that. Yeah, that's, I think that's what I'd call good practice in general.
I mean, yeah, speaking about that, is something that I've started putting together is kind of safe foods that I can quite actually just, or for like breakfasts, lunches and like snacks and dinners or whatever, and just kind of safe meals and stuff, you know, you're not going to go nuts on, for just general pop clients. Cause I know even though I kind of laid out to one of my online guys, he was like, oh, I kind of want a meal plan. And I was like, I'm never going to write you a meal plan. Cause it's kind of what I don't really like about that. But for you, we can give you kind of safety net foods and be like, yeah, if you feel shit, this is the food you're just going to go and eat. And that's what you'll do. If you're going to binge on something, go binge on this. If you're going to do that, just have that. Just because I think some of the macronutrient for general pop can get, like you say, a little bit like, oh shit. Then you get all these questions of, I've hit my calorie content, but I don't know whether I can hit my macro content, or seem to hit my macros, but my calorie content's down. It's like, oh, well, maybe my fitness pal hasn't tracked it perfectly. If you hit those, you're absolutely fine. And just like, there's so many on the list. Where is it going? So if anybody's not using my fitness pal, they've actually, the recent update, I don't like, I got really confused on it today.
It's annoyed me as well.
Yeah, yeah, I don't quite know what's changed, but and like the calories are just, I just didn't like it. I don't know, revert it back. Maybe I'll just take that. Damn you, my fitness pal. It's slightly
change
annoying.
Change is not good.
It's not cool. I think I've resisted and not updating it for a while, and then that's happened. So also, obviously what comes with good practice, bad practice comes. What are the common, what are the common mistakes or common misdemeanors or kind of common things that you get if maybe a client's just started off flexible dieting or just started off macro counting? What are the common pitfalls that you might see?
I think probably the most common one is lack of fruit and vegetables. It drives me up the wall. I don't know why, it just does drive me up the wall, because I quite explicitly say on their spreadsheets is just like a general calculation of how many fruit and veg they should have per 1,000 calories. Yeah. And that kind of, and I put it on the higher side. So they should be having like 2 to 3 per 1,000 calories. And when I don't generally dive into people's my fitness pals, because I like, you know, it takes a long time. I've got 30 clients and I don't really have the time to delve into everyone's my fitness pal. So I trust that they are. But if I see their fibers down and then I look into their my fitness pal, virtually always it's fruit and veg is just almost just non-existent. And then they may even complain, and often I've checked because they're complaining about being hungry and things like that. So then I check the foods they're eating. It's like, well, you're missing your like highest volume, most satiating foods. Like fruit and veg really should be abundant. And I think that's a bit of a kind of misconception people get. If it fits your macros, they think, oh, I can, don't need that stuff. But you really do, because it will help you hit your macros. It's almost, you can't do it without, unless you're bulking, and then screw fruit and veg.
I mean, yeah, especially when I know that we've done it in the past, for say like powerlifters who prepped, is because you're giving them a kind of rough, especially off season and building strength, I give them a rough guide of calorie content and protein content. And I literally say kind of like, vegetables, apart from potatoes, are pretty much free. Just eat them. I just like, I want you to eat, kind of don't even have to track much of your veggies because it's just volume a lot of the time and getting you full, especially if you're going the other way and losing weight. It's the easiest way of losing weight because you have a lot of volume and far less calories and higher nutrition, which a lot of people, it's one of the biggest things that I know I've noticed that I've done it, especially when my protein target like went skyrocket, and obviously Dan does my nutrition for me and he jumped up my carbohydrates and I just kept on eating really high carb protein bars most of the time. Not really thinking about my fiber content, but protein bars generally have quite a lot of fiber and and you end up on the toilet a fair bit. So
that does my head in as well when I give my clients, not the toilet part, although that does do my head in, when people use protein bars as their main, like Quest bars as their main source of fiber, if I see my client like a week where their fiber suddenly doubled, it'd be like, have you bought some Quest bars this week? Like, yeah, this is what, like, you can't chew, like, I don't know the whole ins and outs of fiber content and things, but I know the type of fiber that's in that isn't necessarily as great as the fiber you get like from fruit and veg. It's just, and you can't not have your fruit and veg because you're having like that fiber doesn't give you all the vitamins and minerals.
Yeah, next to each other and be like, they're the same, dude. Come on. It's just like, yeah, but we'd much rather you have like some chicken and a load of lettuce and shit than that Mars protein bar. I know I have like tons of them, but it's just, if I can, I'd much rather go that. It's fine as kind of, I mean, I advocate it for people who are personal trainers because I get sometimes that meal prep goes out the window, or especially I'm gonna call myself out here because sometimes I have meetings I get called to across London, and then I would quite happily just munch a protein bar knowing that I'm probably okay, but my last meal of the day I always kind of set out to be 2-3 veg whatever and go. I mean, if you're if I'm stumbling over my words a little bit here and I'm a little bit giddy, I have eaten too much pineapple today because I know my fruit is down and my tongue's gone a bit and my stomach's a little bit off, so everybody's done that and apparently I'm 10 years old and can't control my food, but really kind of odd. So anything else that you feel is important for people just setting out, or anything they need to set out when they're doing their flexible dieting, anything?
Probably my biggest want for anyone starting it who isn't completely sure, plan a day in advance. Plan a day in MyFitnessPal that hits your macro, like within your macronutrient ranges, hopefully most people use kind of a range to hit, and hits your calories and hits your fiber, and then that can be like a that can be your meal plan for a few days. And once you get confident and comfortable with that, you can start exchanging foods like chicken for turkey or lean beef or something. And then once you get confident with that, you can move on. It's when people try and they go with it and they're like, right, I'm just going to free ball my day. I'm going to have pancakes and syrup for breakfast. And then it's like the end of the day, they're starving, haven't got their fiber in, and like have to get 100 grams of protein. They're just like, right, I'm just going to have a big shake. And they completely screw that up.
I think, a lot of this time we always talk, because people can't, budgeting basically, especially if we talk about a weekly target, as we would start to as kind of athletes, if we use the term kind of loosely there. I know Dan would go at this, but you kind of hit a macro target for a week. And if you start laying that out for people, they're like, what? But you kind of turn it to money. You're like, actually, you've got this amount of money you have to spend the whole week. I was like, if you kind of don't spend enough, you'll be in, like in a deficit, so you've actually got calories to spare. And if you spend too much, then you're going to have to rein it back at some point and actually you're going to be in the shit. So it's an analogy that I use quite a lot, for people who actually understand money a little bit better than calories, even though it's just numbers, amazingly. I think one of the biggest advocates I'd be... Yeah, I'd say that's very similar to you in terms of where you can commonly go wrong. It's not laying stuff out previously. I know through a few people, personal trainer-wise, that they'll have a skeleton of their day and then they can insert random foods for their snacks where they can freeball it, but they've probably got already laid out for the next couple of days all the boring shit. Which is one thing that I actually called out the whole of kind of Team Box on was... and I told a few people to do it, was we on inflexible dieting, and I think we're probably both included in this. We all always post out the really exciting kind of foods that we get to eat and be like, yeah, I'm dieting and yeah, this is awesome. Look what I get to eat, this burger and everything like that. But let's say that 80% of the shit that we eat is fairly boring and standard and like kind of regimented. Mm-hmm. But that's the rigidity, and we've got probably 15, 20, 25% of flexibility of kind of freeballing, but not really going off our diet essentially. But I think we fall victim on social media quite a lot of doing that. Maybe there's like it should be a hard home truth every now and again, but actually most of it's boring shit. Get used to it, and now we can drop back. So by the way, you can swear on this podcast.
Oh, good.
I've just done it about 7 times, so yeah, we've made sure it's definitely explicit. Don't worry.
I was just gonna say, I think it's an easy trap to fall into posting those sort of ones, especially like coaches and things, because what is like flexible dieting isn't particularly sexy, like hitting macros and like making sure your calories are in check. So our one like sex appeal is like, right, you can eat some Ben and Jerry's at night, like a portion probably fits your macros and is okay. So I think we can give ourselves a hard time for it though sometimes, because it does then people who don't understand it completely view it wrongly, and then they just, like anything, when it's like Chinese whispers, they get the wrong idea, then they start hating against it, and they're hating against something that isn't what most people are trying to sell and suggest is the way to go about things completely.
Awesome, man. All right, should we tap that there, and let's move from flexible dieting into flexible training. And it's something that came up with, so I run on a Friday down in Towerbridge, part of the Third Space kind of group. I do some like mentorship and some workshops and stuff within my deal is programming and I'm biomechanized. Everybody knows that you listen to the podcast. I do a lot of training technique, etc., and breathing, bracing, tension, and getting mechanically kind of regressing, progressing movements. And what I'd like to talk to you about as well, because I know obviously you train and obviously you program for a hell of a lot of people, and if you're strictly online, am I right in saying that?
Yeah, all online. Yeah,
cool. So most likely, I know for a fact, because obviously I do some online coaching myself as well, that this comes up, and with a lot of people it will always come up. If you're not flexible with your training whilst you're doing a workout, a lot of people get stuck and end up maybe training for 2 hours when they haven't. So what I mean by flexible training is the one that we were chatting before is, I was chatting for one of the guys on my little program. He was like, yeah, I kind of, get bogged down. If the lat pull down machine is in my program, I have to use the lat pull down machine. And I was like, all right, well, why don't you just like, there's free cable Cybex machines over there. Why don't you just rack one of them up and kind of do closed grip and just sit on the floor. He was like, it's not what it says. I was like, yeah, but what's your goal is physique. What does it matter? You're still using the same muscle group. You're still using, you can squeeze, you can do tension. Absolutely fine. You can do tempos. You can, believe it or not, 4 sets on just one day, 1 week out of switching out your lat pull down for a closed grip lat pull down is not going to make a hell of a lot of difference. I get big compound deadlifts and stuff like that. Obviously, you're not going to go, actually, I could probably, instead of doing my free RM test, I could probably kettlebell swing. Yeah, I realized that that's not the same thing. But within these kind of the supplementary exercises, there should be, personally, I feel, obviously, comes with education, comes with knowing how gyms are set up and where you can go and what movements there are, but there should be a legitimate element of flexibility within people's programs, so it kind of stops people getting bored as well. Mm-hmm. As one of the big things. What's your take, man? Anything?
I think you're completely right in that the flexibility has to make sense. So for a deadlift, and you've got a specific like 80%, like 3x4 or something, like you need to do a deadlift. Like you can't go and choose something else and try and make it up. Especially if you're a powerlifter, and specificity for those movements is absolutely key, especially like going into a meet. There's no way I'm going to say like you can go and switch to something else. But if you are like a physique athlete, a bit of variety now and then is probably going to benefit you in that sense. Like just like not all the time, because obviously we need those movements to be ingrained, you can progress with them, but just chucking in something random, like if you're on holiday, it's just a good example, you can't access those things, you can still get in like a vertical pull. As long as you know what vertical pulls are, then you can do that, or like a horizontal push, press, like as long as you have those sort of concepts in mind, I think it's really important that you don't spend hours in the gym doing that, because yeah, that'll drive you up the wall. You won't want to adhere to your program at all. I think flexible training is a really interesting subject as well, because many people don't think about it, but it's just like the macronutrients. Like you have protein, you have to hit 10 grams of protein, say. You can pick and choose all these different things. It's like you have a vertical pull, you can do that. Pull-ups, chins, and a lat pull down. Obviously, you don't want to switch it all the time, but when you have to, it's better than not doing it or spending absolutely ages in the gym.
I think especially for obviously through speaking with a head of a lot of general population clients, I will quite happily switch it from week to week just because I know their issue. And maybe it's a corrective more than anything else that I'm doing with them. So there's going to be no issue with me switching a bench press for a floor press. I wouldn't bat an eyelid if the bench press isn't free. I'd just be like, all right, lie down there, get some heavy dumbbells, let's go. Instead of wasting their time or anything like that, you can still do the intensity. You can still get what you kind of want for a hell of a lot of, obviously our listeners I know are general population kind of trainers. Maybe if they might get annoyed themselves considering they might have planned it so perfectly and then shit isn't right in the gym that they can't go to. But so obviously within powerlifting, doesn't really happen that much out of season, maybe in season, like prepping for a meet. I've got a meet next weekend. My training is very, very dull and boring right now.
Yeah.
I asked my coach if I could do some single limb exercises to do it. He was like, don't really want to change too much, but you're cool. I was like, you're kind of guilt tripping me into saying, off, Tom, basically.
But don't get doms.
Yeah, exactly. But I did, just to inspire him, I did it like 2 weeks prior. I did some barbell split squats and fuck me, Jesus. Yeah. So I haven't done unilateral work for at least 6 months. And I did one batch of 4 sets of 8. Wow. My ass was gone for at least 4 days. And people are always baffled by that. They're like, but you train all the time. Like, you should be. I was like, it doesn't.
Not like this.
Like that little change is just, yeah, really different. So with the bodybuilding aspect, I can get, there needs to be a certain rigidity. Again, obviously we're setting out the program a hell of a lot, but I'm going to say I think for kind of when you're doing kind of tension work and stuff, you can manipulate it a hell of a lot, and you're probably more concerned about getting the reps and high quality reps out than and the correct plane of movement than it has to be this certain exercise, I would say. I know is it Jeff Alberts does a hell of a lot. He kind of advocates high quality reps over, yeah. Obviously the guy's like insane and he's been going forever, so that kind of kind of says why he's always kind of he'll always take a step back if he feels like form is dropping.
Yeah,
always step back and just be like, actually no, the reps are far more important and getting those high quality reps in than the load that is on the barbell or in your hand. I think that's a hell of a lot of, yeah, there's flexibility within loading as well. So in terms of bodybuilding, that can always be an issue. I think I know a couple of my guys are like, I think were spouting on like the big supplementary exercises where it was just like curls and tricep extensions and stuff. It was like, oh, these haven't like moved like loading wise for at least like a month. I was like, I couldn't care less. Are you saying you want to lift really, really heavy on your tricep extensions? He was like, it doesn't matter, man. It's like, I'm looking at those first 2-3 exercises for them to move. So in terms of flexibility, yeah, I think when it starts to educate, I think we can just literally do insert tricep exercise here or insert vertical pull, vertical push. That's a lot of the course that I start teaching. We talk about that a hell of a lot in correctives. So yeah, good to know that there's somebody else that thinks that.
I'll just say, in addition, you can get really quite flexible with it in terms of if you've just got a volume that you need to hit for the week, you don't necessarily have to do that on that day. Like, you can be quite flexible. Like, a lot of the studies show, as long as kind of you're hitting that volume for the week and the intensity is there, you pretty much see very equal results. So if you just have a checklist that you have to, like, I know 3DMJ advocate this as well, like, for some athletes, they just have, right, you've got to get this much volume in on this particular exercise by the end of the week, do it when you feel good or when you can, and then you can do it like that. Or if you've got, if for some of my guys who are a bit more advanced, they really understand things, if I have like heavy workouts, medium workouts, like light workouts in terms of intensity, they can be like, right, I actually don't feel very good today. I'm going to do that lighter workout because that's a lot easier. So just the ability, I think the education comes first and then you can be really flexible with it. It's the same with flexible dieting. The more you know, the more you've done it, like the more flexible you can then be, which is really cool.
I think that not in a bad way, but it's kind of bringing the death of kind of the classic body part split. It seems to be going out the window. I know.
Yeah.
I looked at Dan Meek's and Stephen Box's programming, and we sat down together so I could look at what they're doing and probably then what they're going to be doing off season wise. And they are literally push pull legs upper lower. They know how much stuff they need to hit. They're training five times a week, blah, blah, blah. They're doing all this stuff, but they're not actually, this is chest and triceps day and all this kind of jargon. And they realize that probably we need to hit it at least, volume-wise, 2 to 3 times a week. This is how many reps we do, blah, blah, blah. So they can switch it around a little bit more. And I know probably the growth of kind of undulating training and either daily or weekly undulating periodization. So are big now, and we've discussed them on the podcast quite a lot, is that people in the industry are trying to actually realize, oh, kind of little and often or is better than just smash once. Hopefully that's what people say.
And as well, you can even think of flexibility, like, okay, you've got we'd plan this to be a 4-week training cycle, but if some days like you end up kind of you can't train, so you have to move a day back, it might be end up a 5-week training cycle. It's not the end of the world if it gets a bit further shift back. I think the important is making from the get-go being realistic about how many times you can get to the gym, how much you can actually do, because some people can get in the gym 5 times a week and be quite short, brief workouts, or some people might need that same work but in 3 days and they can spend quite a while. As long as you kind of have the basic understanding that you just need to do a certain amount to progress, then you can actually be quite flexible and like do a lot with it.
All right, man, awesome. I think that's enough knowledge, that's enough content. We might as well actually find out the plans for your Team Revive Strong. Okay, so you got you I think it's reasonably recently you hired, well, brought in Mark to do some stuff with you, right? So what's the story behind, so a little bit of expansion and what you're doing social media wise, anything like that that you think is going on?
I think I'd like to say I have a really well planned out business plan. I very very much don't. The whole way I've built my business from the very get-go was just content creation, continual value giving out to the public, and just trying to do it in as many different ways as possible. And in the last probably 6 months, I think the company's grown quite a lot because I've probably found my voice and been able to give my kind of twist on things. And I think I like my position at the moment because I get to learn, and like yourself, from so many different experts and kind of pick and choose and mold your own kind of approach that comes from all these elements. And it's really quite nice. And I think a lot of my clients really like that because they're like, oh, you don't have a dichotomous way of doing things. It's obvious you've picked bits from other people, and it's really cool. It's really nice. And I think, I brought on Mark quite recently. I'd been thinking about bringing on a coach for a while, and Mark fit the bill because he's kind of very similar to me in terms of his ideas and approaches, and also he has that great backstory. And of course, it's by no means a necessary requirement for someone to have gone through like a traumatic experience and then come through it.
People would be flying to jobs with you, and they'd be like, "Yeah, I'm relatively normal. nothing's happened."
So, yeah, just I think if anything, that just it kind of built a character in both of us, so we had similarities and we could kind of connect with each other. But he brings stuff to the table that I don't. So I came from being very skinny, like very food conscious, clean eating, a bit orthorexic, you might call it. Whereas he came from kind of his, because he went on various drugs that caused him to gain tons of weight and he just was really out of shape. He came from being really big, losing a lot of weight and gaining some muscle. Whereas I was like the smallest thing ever and then tried to build up. So he is a lot of experiences I'll never get. I'm never going to be obese and lose weight, I don't think. I'm hoping.
Yeah.
Whereas he's done that. So he brings that to the table, which is really nice. And I think for us at the moment, it's just about building the company bigger, having more clients, maybe bringing on more coaches. I do have some smaller group coaching things that I run, a mini cut movement. So 6-week mini cut, basically done for you, training programs there. It's like you said, it's flexible. I've got different options of how you can make it manage to your lifestyle. And then I've actually got a 16-week because people in there were like, what do we do after? I was like, well, okay, I'll produce like a bulking one. So I've got a 16-week kind of get big, stay lean course, which is, 16 weeks of programming done for you, progressive, flexible. And yeah, it's really cool. It's growing. And now the podcast's out. Podcasting, as you know, is actually a ton of fun. People, and they've been around for ages, but they've really grown in the fitness industry like the last year. I love them. Like, so, they're a good excuse to walk and listen, educate yourself, and you get to connect with loads of people, which is really great.
I think one of the biggest, why we started it, because Dan was kind of thinking about moving out of London, and we didn't want to stop kind of working together. We had very similar connections. We came from slightly different backgrounds in terms of like nutrition and biomechanics, but then we had our variety of stuff that we wanted to look at. But the connections thing is, it seems like everybody in the industry who what it literally says, oh, if you want to do a podcast, we would come on. They were like, yeah, awesome. Like, they're great fun. They're just, you just get to sit and talk about the stuff. Believe it or not, most of the time that a lot of us talk about when we're with each other is fitness, and a lot of the time we enjoy it. So anytime we can spread that as much as possible and realize that other people are doing good work is actually really good. How did you get into the fitness industry as well? Because I know through looking through your Facebook, more than anything else, you weren't in it from the get-go, from the start.
No.
You did your degree in geography. Of sorts.
Yeah, geography and business.
Which lays itself into bodybuilding and powerlifting perfectly. So, yeah, what was the deal?
So, I actually wanted to do economics university. I loved economics. And actually, I see so many parallels within various concepts of economics to training and nutrition, which is a bit of a side point. But that's why I did geography with business, because it was kind of, I was good at geography, business was there. I really didn't know who I was, what I wanted to do when I went to uni. I had really no idea. I didn't have a great time at uni. I was pretty isolated. I didn't do loads of going out and partying. I didn't know who I was at that point. It sounds really weird and like a bit like mystic or something, but I just didn't feel like I was Steve. I was kind of in my shell and I didn't come out. And yeah, during my second year at uni, it was just before kind of the exams at the end of the year, I was doing so many sports. I've always loved sport. I've always been to going to the gym. I was on like a typical 10-kilometer run, got hit by a van on traffic lights. They're flashing amber. And I was just like, I was on for a PB, went for it, got hit. Like it wasn't great because it was a head injury and that led to all sorts of kind of long-term ill health. But it was kind of at that time, I needed something that I could control because I felt very much out of control of my life. I kind of couldn't control my health. I couldn't do things I wanted to do. So going to the gym, taking control of my nutrition, which bodybuilding is very kind of selfish. And it's like, it's all about you, really. That's what drew me into it. Because I was like, oh, I can actually now manipulate my body to do these various things. And then I've always liked science, education, learning stuff. So then I found like Lyle McDonald, Alan Aragon, after a lot of mishap and kind of the typical shit that you do, like bro splits and eating clean and all that rubbish, kind of was, it was quite painful. So like, it's not fun going through that, but eventually I did that. And I've always been a very determined person. So I was actually told to take a gap year at uni, but I did my third year, went through it. I didn't do as well as I hoped. I was meant to get a first from my tutor, like he was telling me, but I got 2-1. I was still really, really happy that I managed to do that, because I really found it hard to concentrate with the head injury and stuff. It just impacted a lot of different things.
Yeah.
So then, yeah, came out of university again. I didn't really know what I wanted to do. My dad had a job available at his company, was like merchandising. So I went there for a bit of time in the office, but always like behind that was me trying to do bodybuilding on the side and like health and fitness on the side. I even started a YouTube channel back then, and I have some really cringeworthy videos on YouTube if anyone wants to watch them. Like some of my first videos, I'm this close to taking them down, but I'm like, it just shows who I am and where I've come from. I'm secure enough in myself to take the piss. Like some of my posing ones I used to do, and I used to try and be like Matt Ogus or someone who I was watching at the time. But that's where I actually found like YouTube and 3DMJ all back then. So I'd actually have had an education with them guys for a long, long time. So on the side, I was trying to do all of this bodybuilding learning and stuff. I then moved to BHS, who have now gone down, if anyone knows. But I worked there, and there was just some great people at that company who kind of got me out of my shell. And on the side, I did a PT course just in case, because I was like, I don't know if I'll ever go into personal training, but maybe, and I can do this on the side. It's not too much work. And I was still doing my YouTube channel and everything then. That was mainly my main outsource. And then I had an opportunity to be a one-on-one personal trainer, and I just took it. I was like, right, if I continue down this career path at the moment in my office job, I'm going to be a merchandiser. I was pretty good at it. I worked hard, but it's not what my passion was. So I quit. I became a personal trainer one-on-one. I moved home because the income was pretty poor. I didn't move home, actually. I was already living at home. Yeah. So it was really lucky that I had their support. I could go into this. And really where the online side grew was I had the YouTube channel. So people already kind of knew about me a little bit. I had a couple of people contact me asking questions and things. But it was that gym in my hometown has a lot of younger guys in there who don't really want personal trainers because they don't need someone to count their sets and reps. But they're clueless in terms of nutrition training, clueless. Like they're going in there and they really don't know what they're doing. Whereas they've seen me doing stuff. They've seen my YouTube channel. They heard me talking about stuff and they knew I knew things. So then they wanted the online coaching because that was a cheaper format for them. And I was really cheap at the time because I was just like, why not? Just do it on the side. I'm going to build this up. And then I decided to do my kind of bodybuilding prep that year as well, because it was when I was working as a PT there, it was a fairly easy job. I wasn't kind of massively stressed. And it all kind of built because I was doing the show. So I was doing more Instagram, more YouTube videos, of getting more attention from people because you're getting shredded and people are like, wow, like look at this. And then people in the gym were coming to me and wanting help, and my online side was growing. So it was just, they kind of grew alongside each other. It worked really well. And I was flabbergasted that I was able to drop my PT hours, do more online side. And then eventually kind of I got into a relationship when I was at BHS, and she wanted to move into London. And so I moved out and did all just online coaching, and my parents were shitting themselves because they were like, how are you gonna, like, what is this online coaching? They didn't really get it. Like a lot of people don't get what online coaching is. So yeah, that's kind of where it all began. And ever since I've moved into London, I've just been kind of working away at it, and it's grown into something amazing. I'm really, really happy to be where I am. I guess that's the long and short of it, really.
That's cool. How did you find the experience from switching from kind of one-on-one PT to online? Do you miss it? Is there anything you still want to do, or is there anything that you want to hang on to?
100% miss one-on-one PT, but I think part of that want for the one-on-one element has helped my online side grow really well, because I make my online guys feel like I'm with them. I try to, because I miss it so much. I love connecting with people, and behind a computer you can't. So when I first set it up, I was just doing email correspondence. I wasn't doing any videos. I don't think I was even doing Skype consults or anything. And so I didn't really enjoy it. And it's only since I started introducing Skype consults, video logs every week. And now I feel like I'm getting that one-to-one connection back. I do miss coaching people through movements and like seeing their face light up when they hit a PR. It's not the same when they post an Instagram post. They're like, I got a PR and I see it. It's not quite the same. And yeah, it was kind of a difficult transition, but because it meant moving out with my girlfriend, it was just like that was the golden opportunity to get into London. And I was 23. I wanted to move out. I'd been at home long enough. I was like, it's good enough reason to. But I miss one-on-one. I want to get back into it at some point. I don't know how, I don't know when, but I do like it.
Cool, man. Awesome. We'll have to invite you into one of the gyms that I run around then. We could actually do that. We could get some sort of workshop going on in central London. Quite easily done. Hopefully we're looking at some push pull leg stuff to do that in hopefully next year is what the plan is. I'm not going to hold myself to that, but online, like we said earlier, but it's definitely in the pipeline at the moment. Actually, we messaged some people out about it.
That's pretty cool.
That's cool. All right. So I think that kind of ends what I wanted to talk about with you. Is there anything you want to plug? Basically, I think right now, I think the biggest thing that I would say for people, if they're not going to join and be one of your clients, etc., or anything like that, to get a lot out of you is you do run, essentially, you're better than me, you run a free online group to go into. It's like macros, bodybuilding and powerlifting, right?
Yeah. Yeah, if anyone wants to join that, more the merrier. I just love the interaction in there. Again, it's probably me trying to get that one-on-one interaction again. I'm just craving interaction with people because I'm just here in my flat alone. Well, Charlotte's here sometimes, my girlfriend.
It's great. I don't post anything on it, but I thought I'd join it because I knew who you were and kind of see what's going on in the group. And it's really good group because it's just, if anything, it's kind of like it's a decent little support network that a load of people have got. And I know there's a few coaches in there because I know the names. I think we've all probably done the same thing as me just to see what there's going on and what's happening.
I do the same. You're trying to see what other people are doing, whether they're doing anything different to you. And it's interesting. Yeah, it's cool having other coaches in there because, I mean, if you do see a question, I mean, I want other coaches to answer it because you may have a better or different perspective to me that I haven't thought about. It's just a great way to educate and, reach more people.
I mean, there's just like, in terms of like topics and questions and stuff like that, the people that are in there just kind of spout out loads of stuff all the time. There's at least like, I don't know, it must be like 5, 6, 7 to 10 posts a day in terms of what people are talking about. And then probably you yourself are one of the most active kind of online guys that I kind of know as well, because you're always... I'm pretty sure it's every day that you're on there doing stuff or kind of spouting out some sort of knowledge or even if it's just general about your day and what you've been doing. It's very kind of current. It's always on point. There's nothing that I haven't disagreed with, which is always
That's
great.
Cool.
I think that was one of the takeaways that I think I went to like a 2-day workshop and Dan was like, there was nothing I didn't disagree with, so I take that as a good thing now. Yeah. I think at the level that we hopefully operate at, you're looking for kind of acceptance of what you're doing more than anything else by the big boys. So go join that group. Hopefully you get an influx, or you might just get one or two
whoever it is. Come and join us, it's fun.
Go for it. So anything else online that you want to shout about, anything that you're doing, anything that's plan wise
I think honestly, for people who want to learn more, the best places for you to get more out of me is from revivestronger.com, because there I have all the podcasts that we do with like Mike Israetel. We're getting the guys from 3DMJ on as well. We've had Andrea Valdez on. I'm talking to Jeff tomorrow, which is going to be fun. We're going to get Eric on and the whole team, Brad and everyone. So, and Alberto. So that's going to be really fun. I'm going to try and expand that as well. So if people want to learn more, revivestronger.com is the place to go. I put an article out every week as well. And yeah, I try and make them as, like you said, you don't disagree with them. So hopefully you guys won't disagree with me either, and you actually take value away from them. And if you ever do disagree with things, let me know, because then I'll be able to talk you through, or you'll be able to teach me something, which is good.
It's interesting. So yeah, is there a day that the podcast comes out?
I'd like to say there was. It's normally Saturdays, but it's not always. We generally film on a Thursday or Friday. I try and get them up by, it was out on the weekend basically. They're generally always there, but it's not always on iTunes. It will always be on YouTube first, because that's just the way I end up doing it.
Fair enough. Yeah, so obviously go subscribe to do that. Go give your stuff a rating, etc. We both know how annoying it is that we have, well, not annoying. I like having loads of listeners, but I like even more having loads of ratings and reviews.
Oh, yeah.
which is always great. Cool.
Thanks for listening to the Pushable Legs podcast. If you've got any questions, don't hesitate to contact us. Go give us a rating on iTunes and Facebook.
So, some intimate questions now, Steve. So something we like to do with guests, especially not ones that I know personally in person, or who I can take the pleasure of being pissed about. just some general questions we like to ask. So gravy or icing, if you had to pick one?
Oh, icing.
Icing. Reasons?
Just jerk reaction was that it just tastes delicious.
Fair enough.
I do like icing. If I have gravy, I normally have vegetable gravy, and just, yeah, I'm not that bothered by it.
Okay, interesting. It's definitely a divide in powerlifters, and a lot of guys have gone towards, strength guys have always gone towards gravy, and physique athletes are going towards icing, which is maybe the sweet tooth or whatever. Brad Loomis was just like, icing all day. Easy. So with that, is there a favourite breakfast that you would go for?
Ooh, it's hard to think of favourite breakfast when you track macros, because you basically make your breakfast to fit your day, and so it's not necessarily a favourite. But recently I've really liked I have cottage cheese, raw tomato, raw pepper and salsa, and it's just super convenient and it tastes good. And I think breakfasts for most people, I think they should generally be like something that hits a lot of your key things. So like getting lots of fruit in, veg in, and like it sets you up for the day. But in terms of actual favorite breakfasts, I love a granola with like a ton of other cereals on top, Cocoa Pops, get some Lucky Charms on there, get some Crave. That, like, I could eat a lot of calories in that meal, like if I wanted to do that.
Sorted, absolutely fine. Yeah, I totally agree with that. All cereal mix is a great thing, like the little selections. And then just kind of taking four and then just, just going, and you're like, what? Yeah, it's great. It's just mixed up. It's beautiful. So being a coach, trainer, physique athlete, powerlifter, favorite exercise?
Ooh. This is always a battle between deadlift and squat for me.
Okay.
Because it was always deadlifts, but there's just nothing more satisfying than a deep squat. It's just something about it. But yeah, I'm going to go deadlifts just because it's definitely squat. Squat every day, like it's squats, because I just feel like deadlifts, if you do a heavy deadlift, you can only really do that once a week. If you squat, you can do quite a lot of squatting in the week, and it's just, so you get more of it.
Yeah, that's
whereas cool. Deadlifts, squats.
We can appeal to our bodybuilding audience now. Favorite machine-based exercise?
Oh, machine. Dude. I think it's probably got to be the lateral raise, where the pad's like on your shoulder and you just get like constant tension, and just that the perfect range of motion and perfect kind of guidance. You don't feel anything else that good.
I can see that. Yeah, that's cool. Also interesting that Brad Schoenfeld had a massive Facebook thing going on about the lateral raise machine about a few months ago. Yeah. He had an argument I think he went into a gym and before the lateral raise machine was there, and then he asked the fitness manager why it had been taken away.
Yeah, I remember this.
And then I think the fitness manager says, dude, we're not going to be on machines. Like, we weren't built like that. And obviously, Mr. Brown Schofield is, Dr. Brown Schofield is just going, what are you on about? It's just like, you're ridiculous. And then he returned about 3-4 weeks later and it had come back. It's a great machine. Yeah, awesome. So in your coaching experience that you've given out exercise-wise or rep ranges or whatever, what is the worst and most awful exercise grouping or whatever exercise that you've given to a client and thought, fuck, they're going to die?
Oh, man. Worst exercise grouping. Or probably
just anything. Worst thing you've ever given to a client. Maybe it could be worst. That's the whole spectrum. Worst as in effort level, or it could be worst thinking, looking back 5 years ago, I had no idea what I was doing.
I think in general, what springs to mind when clients complain to me, it's hip thrusts. Like, they're just like, I look like an idiot. they take me twice the time to set them up than it does to actually perform them. And I get horrendous glute DOMs. Like, people, I think they love them really, but to set up, they're a pain. Same with seal rows. Everyone loves seal rows, but they're like, I can't do seal rows in my gym. They're complaining that I'm like using the boxes and putting them up in weird places. They're both great exercises. They're just both a bit of a pain in the ass to set up. So I think that's probably the worst. I don't think my training for people, luckily, has ever been awful. It's definitely improved a lot since I started. But I don't think I've ever completely done things wrong, which is good because that makes me feel better. But it definitely has improved. And I've definitely made mistakes in the past, but never like totally wrong, like giving a marathon runner kind of heavy one rep max squats or something stupid.
Day before the London Marathon. That'd be good. Yeah. You could go full Brett Contreras and just go, he keeps on every like other week, he's putting out his post about frog pumps and doing like new PR, like 185 frog pumps, one hit. What? if your clients think hip thrusts look weird, get them doing.
I've started, ever since the PTDC, I started introducing a few people with frog pumps.
Yeah, I do them as a little bit of a warm up. I don't think I'd add, I don't know whether I could stop laughing if I put them as a main exercise or do a supplementary.
Like throw them in the end or something.
Yeah, just be like, yeah, it's just frog pump. They're like, what? What was that? Okay. Yeah, you do this. It looks bafflingly weird. All right, last question. Bodybuilding or powerlifting?
At the moment, I've got to say bodybuilding, primarily because I've been a bit injured, which has let me not squat and deadlift heavy for a long time. And I also have a slap tear. I don't know if you know of this. It's like a tendon within the shoulder. So my bench press sucks ass so bad. And it pisses me off all the time because basically I'm here and this arm's wobbling like this.
Yeah.
And I'm very unstable. So I like bodybuilding because even if you are injured, there's so many workarounds. There's no specific exercises you have to get kind of entrenched with. So you can do like I was doing BFR on my legs for a period of time, which was fucking cool and painful, but at least there's a workaround. So I think at the moment I like bodybuilding a bit more, but I love both. They're both cool.
Awesome, man. Awesome. All right. So it's come to the point of the show. You're more than welcome to join in if you want. You're obviously online a hell of a lot, but me and Dan play our game of stupid things and cool things on the internet.
Ooh, that sounds like bollocks. Probably because it is.
Stupid things on the internet this week.
And what happens is we don't even have to work for it anymore. But obviously Dan's been away and he's been online a hell of a lot. He's found tons of stuff.
Oh, nice.
But most of the time our listeners send stuff in to us.
Sweet.
So I'll just pick, because I'm in a long, I'm always going to go down this road because I'm in a long standing battle with the people who have created these fucking attitude masks. So what one of our listeners is, Mr. Seb James, has shown me a little picture. I'll put it up. Let's try and not get the guy's Instagram. I think I'm not going to be able to. Screw it. Oh, well, doesn't matter. There we go. This guy.
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, so what this actually is, obviously, I've gone out of my way to troll the people who make the Altitude masks and have written various stuff and then actually posted on directly onto their feeds some academic journals proving that they don't work, which didn't take too kindly, apparently. I got a lot of likes, which is great. But this person... Well, it's in general, as trainers, I think we should always be evidence-based or whatever, or even if the evidence base is anecdotal and there's something happening that even if you can't explain it, like there's a lot of, I mean, we were talking about the PRI stuff a hell of a lot of weeks ago and all this kind of jargon, but the altitude training masks are not altitude training masks. And there are now trainers who are calling themselves altitude training mask specialists. So this is my problem, that one, without a hypoxic chamber, I'm lucky enough to work in a facility that has a hypoxic chamber and I don't use it because we talked about this extensively. Live high, train low, so you get the most out of your training. You have to live in altitude to get as much kind of that effect as possible. There's 167 hours during the week. You thinking 3 hours of your week being in there is going to change anything? You're ridiculous. And if somebody, a PT who says they are specialist in altitude training, I would expect to be training at altitude most of the time and not in Bolton with a mask on. All right, I don't know what your thoughts are on the mask. If you own one, then fair enough.
Just imagine if I just pulled it up. It's just my Bane mask. Don't worry.
Great. No, Bane costume.
I haven't actually. It's one of those things where I've seen it posted around the internet a lot, and I just like, you know, when you just see something, you're like, I know that's fucking bullshit. I'm not even going to waste my time looking at it. And I, luckily for me, because it's nothing related to bodybuilding or powerlifting, I just don't have to even talk about it. So it's like, yeah, I can just get rid of that sort of crap. It's so frustrating when you see these things. I've seen them all over the place. Luckily, I don't really see them around in my gym and things because, yeah, I'd probably end up.
No, I think you're in the lucky aspect of maybe that's what I need to start moving towards, because I still consult for kind of professional sports teams, etc. And yeah, when you see people that are Premiership football players wearing them, which is always fantastic. I'm sure their paycheck is wonderful, but I'd rather not wear it, especially if I was their S&C coach. I probably know a couple of the S&C coaches at those football clubs, and they're either being told to shut up or they're just lazy and don't want to tell them to stop wearing it. So PTs. My stupid thing is PTs that are specialist altitude training mask trainers.
That's so bad. That's worse than macro coaches or something like that. Like, yeah, at least like you can do a macro coach. I kind of get that a little bit.
What would you deem as a macro coach?
I think it's someone who, this is how much pro, they're basically like, they go onto what they do for you is they go onto ifitfitsyourmacros.com and use their calculator and then charge you for doing that, because I guess it's a little bit of effort involved.
That's crazy.
I think people have chosen to call themselves macro coaches and haven't necessarily, I think I'm probably being a bit unfair with that. I think probably some of them are just using it because it's like a known term. They could be called a flexible dieting coach or something.
Yeah,
I'm hoping that's not what they do at least, because that's ludicrous. If people pay money to get told what a calculator could tell them.
Yeah, I mean, it's great when I've actually had a couple of my friends who have kind of messaged me and going, I'm trying to find out what macros I should be on, but I've gone on the internet and it said about 7 different things. I was like, yep, that's right. That's why you employ me and then you'll find out. And they were like, fuck, yeah. So, quite interesting. Anything stupid you want to say? Obviously, no pressure if you don't want to.
I guess I had something in my head. Oh, that's the one. This is, I don't know if it's necessarily that recent, but it really pisses me off, is related to footballers. Ronaldo's been trying to sell this ab trainer that they've been around ages, these waist trainer things. God, they're such bullshit. And it really annoys me that why would anyone buy that seeing him in it? He's obvious that he's been in shape before he's ever put that on. He doesn't use that crap. What frustrates me is, again, him, because he does a lot of stuff for charity. He's a nice guy, but he does stuff like Herbalife. He's advertising for this ab trainer. So it's frustrating that he's got like this bullshit along with his actual good stuff. So yeah, those kind of things that contract your muscles for you, I think they're the biggest waste of time you could ever. Yeah.
Yeah, I think we'll go into it more depth next week. But there was one that Dan posted, like tagged me in, was essentially like an ab belt of sorts, but it didn't electrocute you. All it was this special material that made a kind of thermic reaction happen just around your abs. So apparently they were like showed a heat map
of, oh my god,
and it was just like that bit that was really hot. And then ironically I looked kind of through the comments and who the people who were like, oh, I want one, and they all lived in fucking hot shit countries like like South Africa, like Dubai, Qatar, all these places. And I was like, why don't you just go outside, or just put a jumper around your waist. I'm pretty sure that'll do the same thing if you really want that to heat up. And we'll talk about the credibility of like thermic reactions over muscle groups and whether that works. It's the research is so minimal, it's unreal. So yeah, awesome, man. Any cool things on the internet you've seen in the past?
Cool. I don't know really.
I mean,
nothing comes to mind.
Spout out anybody that you is worth a follow.
I have to give credit to Mike Israetel, to be honest. He has been incredible over the past kind of few years that I've been following him now. And I probably am a bit biased because obviously I brought him over. I don't know if you know, I brought him over for a seminar in the UK.
Okay.
And so having done that, and he comes on the podcast and stuff, but the content those guys put out, Renaissance Periodization, they think about things in ways that I've not thought about things. And that's why I liked Mike, because I don't know, a lot of people, and it's great stuff, but it sings the same tune, whereas he kind of is singing the same tune, but in a slightly different tone. So I've learned stuff off him in the past few years that I'd never heard about it. And it's incredible, the stuff they put out. And yeah, they recently, I don't know if you know, they put out that Understanding Healthy Living book, or Healthy Eating, sorry. And it was just, it's so refreshing to see people put out content for the general public who can then understand things and they can take on board kind of these big priorities. So I think if there's anyone, I'd have to give credit to him.
So go have a follow, Mike Israetel.
He probably doesn't need more advertising, but
go follow us, screw it. Yeah. Yeah, cool. So I'll shout out to you. So you're pretty decent on the internet. You're all over the place in terms of all your social media activity. So platforms wise, where can we go find you?
So I'm Revive Stronger on basically everything. Snapchat I do every day, Instagram, don't really tweet much. Facebook, my personal and my page, I normally do a couple of posts every day on those. And then, yeah, the group. But if you find my website, basically everything's there. If you email me, whatever you want to do, I'm kind of, if you've got questions about anything we've said, I'm more than happy. I'll send you an email at some point and get back to you.
And if you're too scared to do it directly to you, do it through me or Dan, absolutely fine. That's happened before. Yeah. We're all cool. So you can actually go on Steve's page and get like some, you can get some free stuff off you already as well, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, go if it's free, it's just go get as much free content as you can. Obviously we give out the podcast for free. We're not paid to do any of this stuff, so it's just we do it because we like it. So yeah, go get some, you got some periodized training plans, like some ebooks, etc. Go have a read. It's all good stuff. Again, if you want questions, just drop a message. And he's online literally every day. So yeah, go do it. Awesome. All right, man. Thanks for coming on. Anything you want to say? Anything else? Nothing?
No, just thank you so much for asking me to come on the show. I absolutely love talking to people in the industry, especially people like yourself. Like, we should have said hi already. We should have like shaken hands at the conferences. But I think the hard thing is with those is they're there's so much content going out, and then the actual networking elements are kind of a bit small, and so people just go home or they're in places. Yeah. So that's why we hadn't done that. But yeah, thanks for having me on, and thank you guys for listening.
That's all good. So yeah, thanks for listening, guys. If the workshops, if you're listening, kind of Lawrence and Luke, let's have like a 2-hour lunch break, and we'll just kind of talk around like little stalls of what we're doing. Maybe that'll happen, or maybe we get a big group of us go down to like Body Power and just laugh our heads off. It'll be all right, man. Thanks for coming on, absolute pleasure. Obviously subscribe, listen to obviously the Pushball Loads podcast. If you haven't subscribed, go do it now. If you haven't left a comment, go do it now. If you haven't rated, go do it now. We've got an influx of Facebook kind of ratings. Let's have an influx of iTunes ones as well. And then go on to the Revive Stronger podcast. I believe that's what it's called.
Macros Bodybuilding and Powerlifting podcast. But yeah, with Revive Stronger, they'll be able to find it.
Cool. Yeah, go on there. I'm pretty much assuming if you click on our podcast, it'll be on the ones that like
this. Oh, probably will.
If you like this, you might like this, or other people have listened to this. It'll probably be down there next to kind of Muscle Box Radio and Mac Nutrition Uni and whatever, all that kind of stuff. Cool, guys. All right. Dan will be back next week. He is back in the country on Thursday. So obviously this comes out on Wednesday, filming a little bit ahead of schedule on Sunday. So we're all good to go. And we will do a Stupid Thing special next week. All right, guys, take care. Have a good week.